slightly declined, has rebounded a bit in 15, and in 16 through 20 is expected to stay relatively stable. Okay, those enrollment estimates are substantiated by a lot of detail. There is birth rate information for children born that are now kindergarten eligible. We look at things like as students progress through the grade levels, we call it mobility factors. Are you building students as they progress from first grade to second grade? And if you'd like to see the detail behind, you know, those enrollment projections, obviously there's a lot built into that that you don't see. This is the result of all that detailed planning. I'm gonna turn it over to Mike. Mike has tremendous experience at the state level projecting revenues for the state. He's gonna talk a little bit about local taxes and property valuations to begin with. And then I think we'll tie it together at the end and give you some ideas of that we share with the board in terms of, you know, well, if you're gonna address the situation you're in, what might be the best levy options you have available to you. And so we'll go from there.
Thanks. Can you hear me okay back now? In the forecast, yeah, the first one you do is forecast valuations.
Closer to.
Closer?
Yeah.
Okay. The forecast that we did back in November for agricultural property, and I know it's a big issue here, is we were forecasting at the reappraisal or the triennial update in 2015 a 39% increase in valuation, and that was what was built into the forecast that the board used in making its decision on how to proceed. When the data was actually out, the actual growth turned out to be 42%, so not a whole lot different from the forecast that we were looking at back in November. Residential values, again, went up about 3%, a little bit under 3% at the reappraisal, which was pretty much in line with, I think it finished around in line with what we were forecasting. So with the agricultural value growth, that's about $7.5 million of valuation that was added due to the agricultural increase. At your tax rates, that's adding about $150,000 of additional revenue per year into the operating budget. This wouldn't include what's happening to your bond millage or your PI, just in the operating budget, it adds about $150,000 a year.
That's just from the farmers, correct? That's not from the property owner?
Correct. That's just from the agricultural value alone.
Okay.
Which is your background?
Which is
your
flesh,
though? I don't see where your resources are coming from.
I'm sorry?
Where's your resource coming from?
They're asking where the resources are coming from for you to come to these numbers.
They're coming from the actual data is from what the county auditor reported to the State Department of Taxation, and that the tax rates and the tax bill are based on. We were using historical data to do it, and we had some preliminary data from the county back in November. We didn't have final data at that point that we were using.
So we already had a county increase in our property taxes as a property owner alone, not an agricultural standpoint. So this is gonna increase the revenue for the schools that you guys have made us aware of here, or not?
Yeah, we have built into here on average for residential property about a 3% increase in the valuations that it would have occurred, and that would have been assumed in the. In
is
here.
This reflected in all your charts that
yep.
we're seeing today?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep, this is the base of the chart. Go ahead.
Okay. You know, residential property, you know, they went up. The county has went up. If you try to sell your house and see what your house is actually worth, when you put it on market, it's nowhere near what the valuation they got in the county. And Brown County is not a rich county in the first place.
We're fixed income people.
Correct.
Well, again, the value, we have no control over what the county does with the values. If you feel you have an unfair amount, you can always appeal your valuations to the county.
They can only ask some questions.
You can
only answer questions
here.
basically what the increase in revenue is about $166 per student. And what we're expecting them to happen with agricultural values, they will stay about the same for the, they'll stay about the same for the next 2 years, so that's the way the law works. In 2018, the district will go through a revaluation, correct? And we're projecting about a 15% decline in agricultural values in 2018. The reason that we show that is if you look at the chart up here of agricultural values, the way the system works is they're updated every 3 years. And so you went through in 2015, and so it would have been compared back to the values in 2012. Now these are the statewide data that are used to on average to assess valuation for agricultural property. In 2012, an acre of property for agricultural purposes was worth about $719 of value. In 2015, it was $1,388. That's a 92% increase. And that's why you have such a big piece. Now, the reason you don't get 92% growth in agricultural property, you saw it was only about 40, is that only applies to land that's in agricultural value. Buildings are not valued this way, and there are certain parts of land that are not in this agricultural value, special agricultural class. And so the 92% increase in what's called CAUV, or current agricultural use value, translated into about a 40% increase in overall ag values. The reason that we are expecting it to decline going forward, and again, if you look at the 2014 at $1,668 an acre was the peak. So even from 14 to 15, well, for the farmers here, it was a 92% increase. Statewide, the value per acre is actually down almost 20% from where it was in 14. And we're kind of expecting that pattern to continue so that when it gets out to 2018, the value will be somewhere below the 1388 that is in place right now, and that will lead to a decline in agricultural values. At least that is what we're forecasting to happen right now. Yeah, there's a couple reasons why the valuations have been going up so much. It started with some formula changes the Department of Taxations began back in around 2008-2009 to essentially modernize the formula a little bit. They were still using yields per acre at that time, what they were in 1984. They were using almost 30 or 25 year old yields at that point. So they did some stuff to modernize the formula. And then at the same time, or shortly thereafter, you had a series of events happen that drove prices up. The prices are primarily driven by three things. They're driven by prices of wheat, corn, and soybean. They're driven by interest rates, and they're driven by fuel costs. Those are the three main drivers. Well, you have record high prices, especially in corn and soybeans, and you had interest rates that were approaching zero. And so you had an input cost that was extremely low, you had a revenue base that was very high, and you saw the increases. The counties that went through reappraisal roughly the 2 years before Brown County did, you would have seen in 2014 that $1,668 an acre would have been compared back to the $700, and that was a 238% increase that happened in 14. It was actually the same percentage that happened in 13, going from 505 to 1205. And so that's kind of why this has happened. There was some changes to the formula that were made last year that brought some of the lower prices in faster than they would have otherwise been. And I know there is ongoing discussion right now for further revamping of the formula that would be done legislatively, although nothing has been introduced at this point to do that. Okay, taking a look at shifting from the revenue side to the expenditure side of the budget, over the last 5 years, the district has actually averaged a negative, just over 1% change in spending per year. So over the 5 years, spending has gone down on average 1% per year. The forecast going forward over the next 5 years is for about a 3% increase annually in expenditures, which is more or less in line with inflation and not unusual coming off a period of having a 5-year average decline in spending where you have a lot of pent-ups, things not being paid for that need to be paid for. Taking a look at the overall spending in the district, we do a lot of work on benchmarking, and this helps districts analyze where they are on their spending in a bunch of different categories. And rather than, we don't compare to, say the districts in your athletic league, which may or may not look like you do, or in your case, you're Wilmington, we wouldn't necessarily compare this district with Wilmington. But the Department of Education determined through a series of factors the 5 most similar districts to this district. And compared to the 5 most similar districts in 2014, which is the last year data is available for, the spending in Fayetteville-Perry at about $94.76 per pupil was about 2% higher than the average spending in the 5 most similar districts. And if you compare that with the state, the average statewide per pupil spending was about $10,900, so considerably below the statewide average. The bottom of the two charts looks just at the certified staffing comparison, certified staffing being primarily teachers. And what it shows is that, again, in 2014, an average per student ratio per teacher of about 17.3 kids per student in the 5 kids per teacher, sorry. In the 5 most similar districts, the average is about 15.8 students per teacher. So basically, you have a ratio of students to teachers that is on the positive side, as we would look at it, of about 9%. Okay, taking a look at some of the work that we did for the district was looking at a series of different levy options. This is the one that was kind of closest to what was decided, a $790,000 emergency levy. And this chart shows the fiscal condition before and with the levy. So you see in 2016, this is spending relative to revenues. Obviously in both situations, they're the same, where spending was about $108,000 above revenues. Without the levy, you see the small increase Stacy talked about in 2017, followed by the negative spending in the purple bars. With the levy, with the $790,000 levy, revenues would exceed expenditures for fiscal year 17, 18, and 19, building up the balance in the district. And then even with the levy in 2020, we're projecting a very slight amount of spending above revenues, about just about $60,000.
That's a deficit, right?
Like
2020,
is
that a deficit?
That's deficit spending. It's not a cash deficit. We'll show you here. The next slide. The next slide shows the cash situation with and without the levy. The purple line, the top part of the table down below, again reflects what was in the 5-year forecast that Stacy showed earlier. The green line is the balances, the projected balances with the $790,000 levy. So even in 2020, while the district may be spending about $60,000 more than it's taking in, there's still a positive cash balance of about $2.2 million at that point. Yeah. And that's really about all we have prepared at this point. It gives an overview of the forecast that the board was giving when it made the decision on what route to take as far as a levy. Station, I'll be happy to answer questions about the assumptions or what went into the forecast.
Mike, could you please explain why we had to, if you want to call it, label this levy an emergency levy? I think that concerns a lot of people when they see the word emergency. Can you explain that, please?
Basically, in Ohio, there are two types of levies. There are what are called fixed rate levies, where you're voting on a tax rate, and fixed dollar levies, or fixed sum levies, where you're actually voting on a dollar amount. That's what you have done, is the type of levy where you're voting on a dollar amount, $790,000. Well, in Ohio, those are called emergency levies. It's just the name that they are given under the law. This type of levy was created back in the 80s, I think it was, that emergency levies came about. Initially, they were designed primarily for a district that had an emergency, but it basically became, over time, it has morphed into basically two types of levies. You're either voting for a dollar or you're voting for a rate, and if you're voting for a dollar, it's called an emergency levy. It doesn't necessarily mean that the district is facing an emergency, it's just the name that is in the law that the state has given.
Also, with an emergency levies are not allowed to grow. As Mike said, they're a flat dollar amount levy. So if the levy's passed to provide $790,000 annually, that levy is never allowed to grow. So if reappraisal activity took place in the future, that levy itself would not grow. It's a static dollar amount levy.
And the same if there's new construction. If a business comes in and builds something here, that doesn't mean you'll get more revenue off of this levy. It just means that everybody else's tax rates will go down, so the levy is still generating $790,000. It's just, again, you're voting on a dollar amount that you want the levy to raise, and then as Stacy said, that is the dollar amount it will raise as long as it's in effect.
But your chart that you had up a while ago, you said that there's a 42% increase just from the agricultural aspect, but your chart also showed that it didn't include residential property. So that's in it. You're going to get 42% off the agricultural property, but then you're going to yet get it off of the residential properties also, correct?
I think you're mixing two concepts.
I guess I'm looking at your chart, and it said agricultural, but then it said residential or non-resident. It mentioned no residential.
This one?
Yeah.
Go back.
This one? Are you speaking about this chart?
I think it's this one right here. No, go back even more.
Yeah, the 42% and the 3% on residential property, that's on your existing levies. Basically what happened was that value came off, that value came on, and it did increase the revenue of the district, yes.
But we just had a residential, not just agricultural,
right,
but a residential property increase,
right,
through the county, so that generated more funds.
Yes, and that is built into the forecast already. Those additional funds are part of the forecast already.
Did you have the slide? Did you have a certain slide you want to pull back up?
Let's find the slide
she wants. It's before this. Well, it just makes more questions for me, but I guess I have to wait for my turn in open form because I'm stepping out of turn because I can just keep going on. And this is, I know I've got to wait my turn. But I have my question down.
Okay.
There's one more than I have. This one.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
Yes.
And it says this yield of 150,000 additional annual revenue or 160. No, it says agricultural variation should be by 42. It doesn't say it's really putting in the residential part.
Right. The bottom note just talks about the agricultural, you're correct. But the residential did also add revenue above the $150,000.
So we're talking about, that's my problem, is because my home is probably worth about
So if you go back to that first, the first page where it's the baseline forecast that we presented, you remember that you saw the $821,000 figure. That figure represents about a $951 per student shortfall. That one deficit, the $821,509. The additional revenue that's coming.
Is that current spending or at future spending?
This estimates the 3% growth that Mike talked about in spending estimates.
Is that future spending?
Yes.
Okay, see, because I have a problem with, I want to know where the future spending is being spent. Show me, because that's not been explained. Tell me where, how much is going to teacher salaries? How much is going to the parking lot? How much is going to the football field? How much is going to this? I have a concern, where are we spending this money? I'm on a fixed income. This affects me greatly.
Yes, the details of the estimated spending increases are in the forecast. Jim, you have a copy of those, and we can provide additional detail. I explained that one thing that we, you know, worked with the board is to define those goals and assumptions. One thing that they made very clear is that there would be no additional staffing. So some of that 3% is simply because of inflationary pressures, such as insurance, you know, demands and those sorts of things. The industry trend for insurance alone is running 9 to 10%.
But nobody's picking up my insurance cost differences. Do you see what I'm saying? I am on a big social security income, and I'm on.
Okay,
but
we can just.
I've got to go on now.
But we can, as you said earlier, when your turn comes, we'll go back to you. Let's keep it on track, and we will discuss some of the other increases, and you know.
I think our goal here is to stock market.
See, this is what people don't understand. What little money you have in the stock market is being chewed up by the economy. Where is this money coming from? Do you want me to cut my veins and give it to you out of my veins? I mean, seriously.
Okay, that's ma'am.
I know that's dramatic.
I'm just saying. Please let everyone else ask questions. I mean, get their questions in while these two are here. Then we'll open it up to the people on the list, starting with Mr. Barber and Wendy Evans, and we'll go down the list.
Wendy Evans. Okay. Yeah.
Any other questions for these two gentlemen? Yes, sir. Here's one thing I think you have to understand is it's just as frustrating as a school district to understand that, wait a second, here's a district that's creating quality product, okay, ma'am, thank you, creating. One second, please. We're going to try to keep this civil, and everyone will get their chance. But what we're trying to say is the way the tax or the school funding is set up, it's based on the factors that Stacy mentioned earlier, the median income, student population. If our student population is declining, that creates less revenue coming in. One of the misnomers out there is, well, why do you have open enrollment students? Well, an open enrollment student that comes here brings in $5,900 each time an open enrollment student comes in. We have 183 open enrollment students attending Fayetteville-Perry School. Ma'am, let me please finish. I will get to your point. Also understand that our own resident student, you would think that the state would give us how much?
$5,900.
No, it's $3,200 per student. So our own students aren't generating as much as the open enrollment students. Now, if you check surrounding districts, very few have more students coming in than going out. We have 183 coming in and 40 going out. Do the math. You take $5,900 per student times 183, that's about $1 million. Subtract the 40, it's about an $850,000 growth. Now, also keep in mind, when that resident student leaves, and chooses because it's not a quality education and they go somewhere else, they take $5,900 with them, even though we're getting $3,200. It's not a system we developed. We didn't design it. I'm not a salesperson. I came to educate. Our teachers came to educate. We didn't come to run tax levies. The Board of Education wants to educate. It's you're venting your frustration at us instead of our state rep. I've got a meeting on the 16th to go speak to our state representatives about it. It's the way it's put in our lap, and it's put on districts. There are other districts that don't have to address this because they don't feel their communities would support it, or their median income doesn't cover it. So that's one of the frustrations and the challenges. It wasn't until this year that we met the free and reduced numbers in the middle school. All the other districts over the past few years were getting grants based on their free and reduced numbers. We have a proud community. People don't want that. But sometimes it's what helps generate revenue for a district. So I also want you to understand, over the 2-year period, our increase per student from the governor's last budget is $1.56 per student. When there was a surrounding rural district, they received $2,200. How can that be? Where does that formula come from? We didn't create it. We just want to continue to have the quality product. Some may differ. I've been in other districts. This is an extremely quality product. And we want to grow and make it better and get some of the things that our students can get. But if you get, yes, sir.
Could you address, when you asked the question of the form, of the funding,
mm-hmm.
how it was handled when you went up?
Yes. As soon as I got that information about the funding, I contacted the state directly, and I talked to the director of budgeting, a gentleman by the name of Aaron Roush. And if I can find my, I'll find it here real quick. Let me find it so I'm reviewing here. Accurately instead of off the top of my head.
Jim.
Yeah, thank you. He was perplexed. He even went to say, well, looking at the increases, the causes or lack of causes, it's important to remember the driving forces. School funding is based on student population, demographics, property value, income of residents, and historical funding gaps. Can you imagine? We just passed and qualified for the third grade reading guarantee bonus because our reading scores were so well. And we qualified for the high school or the graduation rate. But guess what? The way the state set it up, it comes in one, but because we got it, we don't get to keep it. We're flatlined, just as the $1.56 per student. Instead of being frustrated at this process, it's the process put down on this community. I get it, but that's one of the challenges. And in the back of his response, he felt it was even harder to answer the question as to why Fayetteville landed on the guarantee in the first place. This is the director of Office of Budgeting for School Finance. His final comments were, which is often answered by the changes in the district over the past several years. I've looked deeper into this situation, and I can tell you that all the schools in Brown County benefited by increased pupil amounts. They also see benefit in new capacity and measured and added by the House bill. This increase in funding for Fayetteville is masked by the offset of the guarantee. That guarantee just took that money that we quote unquote earn, let it go through, and it no longer exists. And that's frustrating from a district. It's kind of like the other big dollar figure is College Credit Plus. College Credit Plus is a great opportunity for students in this community. It's 100% funded up to 30 credit hours in three local colleges. And in two of them, we have to pay for the books, and when I say we, some people say the college pays for it. There is one college that does pay for the books. Two others, we pay for the books. One book for one child was $250 for one class. That just gives you an idea. Now, was this funded? Did we receive any extra funds to do this? No, we did not. Did we get time to train our teachers? Because guess what? If our teachers teach the class here for that college, we still have to pay. You would think the college, since they're getting the student, would pay our teacher. No, and guess what? Our teacher has to go and get extra training out of their pocket so that they can do that. That makes no sense. It's a great opportunity, but it's an unfunded mandate. is kind of like the gentleman, Mr. Husted, last weekend said he doesn't agree with pay to participate. He feels every school should have students to participate in athletics. It's great if you can afford it, but if you can't and you take the pay to participate away, like Grove City High School did when I was at West Fall City Schools, and 2 days later, we had 34 students showing up at our doorstep because their families still wanted them to play in athletics. What came along with them at the time? $5,500. So it's a funding dynamic that is challenging. It's not run like a business. The one folder over there that says all the unfunded mandates in the last 40 years, it was done by an individual at the Department of Education. I'm sorry, the building sector, business sector, hired to show districts how to run schools like a business. What he found out was there's no way he could. And now he 100% funds that. He's coming to Brown County in August to speak to the entire county about this process and the problem. So that's, I understand your frustration. I don't want to take away from the thunder of the questions that are coming up, but please understand, this isn't something that was looked upon lightly, and it's not something anyone, I'm not here to say, we're here to tell you to vote. We're just here to tell you to share the information and the frustrations that are on both sides of the table. We appreciate your candor and your frustrations in sharing it, and it's similar here. But all we can do is remain professional, try to do the best we can. Some of the purchases we've made this year alone were used equipment. We purchased a used bus for $7,700 from another district with the handicap lift. Try finding one of those at that price that meets the state inspection. But that's how the district tries to spend their funds. So it's not like there's been waste. I've been in a district where there was waste. There's not a lot of waste here. It's been done on a tight ship. And I'll turn it back over.
Mr. Brady,
yes.
Could I have you address one thing? Wendy, I felt just a little bit when we said quality product. I think that it came out in the paper what the elementary, the scores for the elementary, but the high school, middle school and high school, and I want Mr. Brady to explain that to you, how that works. When you score high 1 year, that doesn't necessarily mean, and do you want me to?
I can do.
Okay.
Well, I think we should wait till I address.
Well, we're on the report card.
Yeah.
It's the same report card. We were just in shock. You think here's public education, and they know schools have ballots out on the levy in March. Okay, and they're coming out with this new test. First time it's going to be used, and what did they deliver? They threw an F on our report card.
Yeah.
And if you checked every other Brown County school, with the exception, I think, one, and I think they had one too, it was in the same, most of them were in the same category. It was called progress, value-added progress. It wasn't in a tested area, it was the progress. Every school in Brown County had at least one F, okay? Also understand that there was a school district up north that had always gotten A's. What they did was they did a random survey across the state of Ohio to all different school superintendents. I received the email, shared our data. It was the only time most of these districts had ever received an F. It was because school districts had a choice. They could take the electronic version with their fourth through eighth graders, or they could do paper and pencil. What most of the data showed was the paper and pencil had a much better passage rating than the technology piece. And keep in mind, we don't have one-to-one technology like a lot of these districts, so those kids are using those computers every day, not just for the test. But one district in the county opted out and chose not to do it, and their scores were pretty good. So that's another frustrating piece. But if you look back at the elementary scores earlier in the year when the paper put it in the article, not only was the fifth grade score the best in the county, it was the best in six counties. And that's hard to do. That's almost unheard of. So it's a process. Is there room for improvement throughout the buildings? Yes. No one's perfect. But when they change the testing process, and oh, by the way, here it is, and there's so much, if it was so accurate, why is there a thing called safe? safe harbor where it doesn't count against the evaluation piece, because it's no longer even being used. Think about that. That should send a message, but it puts educators in a very challenging position. What are we going to do next? What test is going to change? What evaluation? So those are some of the other pieces that you may or may not be aware of.
So to make it a little simple, if you did well, you've got to do better or you're not going to be. Do you understand what I mean? If you made an A and you don't add to that the next year, you're going to be down at the bottom again. Does that help a little bit?
I can't believe that would be.
That is the way they.
It's a great for improvement.
Value added. That's the way they do it. I'm sorry, you know.
Well, if you're at 100%, then you can't add that.
That's how you get an F.
Exactly.
That's how you get your F. You know?
We're going to get back on track. Are there any more questions?
That's the way they do it, Wendy. I mean,
Mr.
Overly
or Mr. Stover? And then I'll turn it back over. I'm sorry. Yes, sir. Then I'll turn it over.
So, Jim, the only thing I wanted to point out is you talked a lot about the state funding formula. Just a little piece of that is visible on your screen. But there are, go ahead and look through the components of state funding that we had to look at to calculate state funding for Fayetteville-Perry. There's all of this information, valuation, compared to statewide averages. There's information with special education, weighting, K through literacy, ELL funding. Those are all components in the formula. But there's multiple places in the formula to determine how much Fayetteville-Perry is eligible to receive from the state. And you can see it's pretty extensive. Schools in the state are required to file a forecast 2 times a year. So they're required to file in October and May. So there'll be another filing period coming up in May. Joanna and I were together at a seminar last week. We looked at Fayetteville's numbers. They are continuing the same trajectory that we presented here. This forecast was presented to the board in December. So things have already changed, but they haven't changed, you know, where some places in the forecast have decreased, there's other places that have offset that. Fayetteville is still in about the same place they were back in December.
And you compared us to another school district that was close by, and they were spending more money than us. Was that Lanchester
The comparison that was on the slide was to 5 districts that are rated by the Ohio Department of Education as most similar to Fayetteville. So they look at things like student enrollment, they look at economically disadvantaged percentages, and those sorts of things. So we could look at and tell you the exact 5 districts that maybe are similar. We don't have that.
The number that Mr. Brady, it was you that had given a comparison. Was that a school in Brown County, or was that a school maybe in Blanchester?
The comparison I gave for salaries for grade? The salary was a Brown County school.
Is that Georgetown?
We have the lowest.
Or was it a similar district as ours?
As the salary comparison I used, it was a school right up the road in Brown County. Their average teacher salary is $60,000. Was it school district?
Was it a similar district?
No, it was a Brown County district. There are similar districts. There's only one district that isn't the same. We are the lowest in every area but one as far as salary, and that's about a $28, $38 difference between us and that other district. And what I don't want to do is start. You can do the research and find out which district. What I don't want to do is start getting the comparison game. We used one figure, and that was the cost per child that each of the surrounding area Brown County districts received, and that was $1.56 for us per child over the next 2 years. Eastern received $105.60 per child, Georgetown $953.65, Ripley
42 and Western 859.76. Bright Local got $2,292 per chilled child, and Lynchburg Clay $1,460. So that's some of the disparity we're dealing with based on, and Stacy, could you also touch on the fact that it's not something we apply for to get the funds, it's something done, and I know you touched on the factors.
Yeah, it's a prescription, and you know, the prescription, the formula is up on the screen, and like I said, it's an expensive formula, but you don't have control over the components that go into the formula. We can discuss the components in detail, but I think you'd be rather bored than dealing with it.
And there was a gentleman with the hat on and glasses that had a question.
Can you explain a mill? I believe some people think we're talking about a million.
A mill is 0.1%. So 20 mills is 2%. So on a $100,000 home at 20 mills, you would pay $2,000 of taxes per year at 20 mills.
And one point that we do need to add, thank you for bringing that up. In 2018, some of that millage is going to drop off, and it will be reduced 1.9%. So the on a $100,000 home, it will go from $267.75 to $201.25, which is about $16.77 a month, is what a $100,000 home would be paying. And I know you're paying. I'm not paying. Please don't miss this person that would be paying if it passed. That was the point there. And one mill, I think Joanna touched on this, she checked with the vocational school, one mill in the vocational school, just one mill, not 7.65, generates how much, Joanna? Over 800,000 for one mill. So sometimes when you hear this large number, Cincinnati Public could run a half a mill levy and get millions of dollars for it.
Well, yeah, because they got all those.
Thank you. They have the businesses and they have that revenue. Yes, sir.
All the money that they pumped into Cincinnati school got in there.
All right. Well, I'm just using them for that example, not the product we're putting out.
Not money, it's a marketing.
And that's one of the primary reasons, if you remember the average teacher salary here, if it's one of the two lowest in the county, but we have teachers that are staying because of the work environment, the community, and so our average salary is going to be higher than the starting salary, but they're staying, and you heard the scores.
But does it make it a better teacher if we give them a raise?
No, here's the challenge. Here's one challenge. Let's not, whoa. Milford City Schools is opening a new elementary school. Milford City Schools, who knows what they're paying, but if you go 4, 6, whatever many years, and other districts around you, that's what we're trying to say. We're in this for the students, the staff, and the general.
problem of the governor's budget and deficit spending. Those are the reasons. Yes, sir, in the back, and then I'm gonna give it back to these two.
Why did they just put on payroll tax instead of property tax?
We had a community session. I can tell you that we had a community session, and it's amazing how some work gets around and some doesn't.
But you know what? I'm not kidding here, and I never got that.
Well, the call was made, it was on the school sign, but we did learn from that meeting. Somebody at the meeting said, hey, you didn't put anything on 50, how would we know if we never came on 50, if we're not on your 1,500 and some odd people, one call list, that was happening? We learned from that. So we had another one today, we had another one, we had one at the Village Inn Pizzeria, and we want to share the message, but at that meeting, the most consistent theme, of the two, was the property tax, because people were familiar with the property tax. But when you hear the term emergency levy, it makes it sound like there's a school district up the road in another county that built new buildings and had to put an emergency levy on, and the perception was they didn't plan. There's another, Lebanon City Schools has run past nine levies in 10 years. The last time we asked for an operating levy was 1979. That's a pretty good ratio. It's not like the money has just been, it's just going everywhere.
Why didn't you come back with a smaller levy, guys?
You saw in Mr. Oberle's forecast how it carries out. We one of the reasons our insurance was so low was we were self-funded. We're in a consortium with the ESC, and our rate of growth was 2 or 3% last year. That's almost unheard of. Insurance is a big driver. One of the things that's listed is factored in with teacher salaries was the fact that they have a percentage of their insurance paid. Okay, listen to this. Here's the other piece to that. Here's the other piece to that. It's unique with the profession. It comes with the profession, and there are other businesses that offer that same thing. One of the negatives in this profession, though, is it's public record. We've had 4 public records requests for information. So those public records requests, not everyone's comfortable. Somebody shows up at your door wanting to know how much you make, how much this, how much that. That's not really, I know it's public record, and that's part of the process. But there are other benefits to other occupations that offer similar things. Let me interject one other thing. 20 years in the Marine Corps, as a private E1, when I got my paycheck at $374 a month, that was my salary. No one said, oh, by the way, if you take the 100% health and medical insurance that you're getting from the government, that factors into $1,250, and you got dental and life insurance, so now you're making $1,480 a month there, Private Brady. No, that's not what I'm making. It's the benefit I get for being in that occupation. That's all I'm trying to say. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. legislators to kind of create a divide in a community when, wait a second, we should be rallying around, why is it only $1.56? Our kids are worth more than that. What is white oak doing? Stacy did was not a comparison that we did. On that one area where it was the statewide that their funding form we used, we didn't do that because in our mind, we're quite similar to White Oak. That wasn't a Brown County school. We just threw that in there because that one would just caught us off guard. And it's local and everyone realized.
$2,887,000, it sounds
form right now.
And the teachers deserve salaries, it's fine, but what's got me aggravated is like administration, you know, we've got about $750,000, personally, that is this way, built two buildings, and up to the top, kind of up, especially for any day part. The other thing, Bobby, this is levy, my question is, where they bring all their, oh, first year, well, they're gonna tear out the track, they don't do, track, it's not asphalt, but they're gonna build, brings the football field.
We can go over that as soon as we let the public people, and those that wanna stick around. I'm gonna turn, any other thing, gentlemen? I think right here, probably the first two.
I don't know how to speak in one of them. Anyhow, I probably don't even need this thing.
I have a mic, it's louder.
Mr. Brady.
Yeah, the one on the podium.
Number one, Mr. Brady said, I didn't get this at the school, when he was apparently at the school.
Mr. Brady.
Because Mrs.,
One moment, need to say your name, your address, it has to be on the record.
I live in Federal Plain Road.
Take your mic, bro. There you go.
Yeah, okay.
You got my address?
Ralph Barber, 20989 Federal Manchester Road, Manchester. I went to school here, so I got my kids. Mr. Brady stated, I didn't get this here.
No, Mr. Brady said he didn't distribute it. We did not distribute it, and it hasn't.
Mrs. Kayher. I added such numbers I can add, but she gave it to me. Number one. Number two, I never apologize for this because Mrs. Kayher ran the figures, and that's why I put the head question on Mrs. Kayher. And I had it right here on my paper, so me and her added it together. Both of these guys have been great. For me, I'm probably the only one in this whole school that they can get into the offices that I never know and talk to them. And they've been very good, and I've been very good, I think. Now, my main goal, and the tax thing, it wasn't 7 point whatever, it was $10 million evaluation. So it does go. $584,000 for this 4-year term. Our supplies and maintenance, our materials, $372,000. The improved capital, I guess it is, $77,000. So when we add those up in the expenditures, and $133,000, I'm sorry, on other objects for 4 years. When we add their expenditures up, it's $2,013,000. Now, our school didn't figure anything like this. The firm come in and raised this thing this much. So I guess we do need $700,000 if we're gonna, I don't know how you operate this thing, but according to what the auditor told me, that this farm thing would bring in roughly $200,000 for the next 5 years. May go down a smidgen, but it's probably gonna raise the houses. Now that's $1 million. So in all, you know, they really built this thing up to be something. It is two, I got another figure. Mrs. Kerr's, or the school, I should say, I'm not going to say Mrs. Kerr, I'm sorry. The figure was $52,000 that she raised, I'm sorry, that the school raised in the revenue index. On the total of the personal service, $130,000 compared to $847,000. $62,000 compared to $584,000. A $13,000 carry compared to $77,000. Total of all the expenditures that our school did was only $206,000. So it's a huge difference, and I also added the $1 million about the tax here for the CAUB, which the budget was $140,000 in the hole in 2020. Now, if you took the $1 million of the CAUB tax, that showed us having $640 to the good, or $860 to the good. So somewhere we have built this budget. And I'm not saying that sooner or later these teachers don't deserve a raise. They get step raises now, maybe not all of them. But, and I'm not saying they don't deserve a raise over the end. But, you know, we're asking for $790,000 a year, and where's it going? Or what are we going to use this for? This is, like I said, $2,013,000, and when you add it up, it rounds up being like $2,219,000 total of both things. The schools, projection for the 4 years, and the firms. This thing's went up to $2,219,000. Now, I just do a little math. I don't know if I'm right. But I took $790,000. Well, I divided it into the $2,219,000 that we raised. When I divided that, I come up with 2.8 years that this $790,000 will pay this huge build-in fight, or whatever you call it, into this new projection for the school system. Then we got 7.2 years left, and I took my 7.2 years times 790,000, and that gave me a plus of $5,688,000.
You did something wrong, buddy. It's good that
they're... No, I don't have nothing wrong. You better ask these guys who's got something wrong, buddy.
We'll go ahead and let them address it.
I went right off their figures. Did I not, sir? Did I show you right off of your figures?
Take it easy, buddy.
To address the issue, I think there's been a lot of numbers flying around tonight, right? Enough so that it can make your head spin. The bottom line is the revenue estimates for the previous 5 years, well, not estimates, what happened in this district the last 5 years in terms of revenue increases, 0.5% average annual increase. What do we have projected in the forecast? 1.3. Over the next 5 years. Now, we can get down and discuss all the factors that go into that. That's the factors that led to the forecast that we presented to the board in December, okay? On the expenditure side, On the expenditure side, the fact is this. Last 5 years in this district, the district has spent on average 1.12% less per year over the last 5 years. When you take all those numbers and you boil them down into a number that's understandable. And over the next 5 years, the projection estimates an annual increase of 3.06%. There's a lot of big numbers, and the school district has a budget of over $8 million. Okay? Hopefully, you can relate those kind of increases to your own personal budget and make your own personal decisions with that information. That's all we can do is share the information. It's your decision whether or not to support the levy or not.
If you set 3.6%, now you're talking the $8 million, I guess, or $8,200,000 on your projection, then how does all these things add up to $2,013,000?
Are you talking the 5-year half annual?
I'm talking the 5-year of how much you raised each category to add up. So that's 15%, 800, that's only $1.2
million. 8 million times
10 is 800,000, and times 5.
I'm not counting compounding. You need to talk about compounding.
Well, my question is this, and I don't care about the percent. I like to see dollars and cents. When I see that they raised this thing in a 4-year projection out to 2020 over what our school just did, $2 million, it kind of puts me in a rampage. Because I'm one of these taxpayers in this building helping Vegas. And I'm not saying
we all are.
I said we don't. But my point is, we are raising, just this personnel service. That to me is pay, whether it be the whole school, it's $847,000. And Mrs. or the Fayetteville-Perry figured 130. So when you add those two together, what our school projected, what they projected, we got a $977,000 projection in the next 4 years. In personnel service, whatever they may be. I don't think. That's fine, thank you. And I'm glad you guys, I hope you understand some of it. It was tough. These guys have been pretty good. He's a little mean and retentive.
And if anyone didn't get a chance to sign, the list is back over there. We have about nine more people. Eight more now.
Great. Can Joanna say what the personnel services are?
I don't really know if I need to do it. Okay. My name is Wendy Evans. I live at 388 Berlin Drive, Fayetteville, Ohio, Lake Lorelei. And we've been accused of the lake as of causing some of this issue, because it's costed the school district funding. I don't know how this is what I've been told. I guess Mr. Brady could answer that question. I'm just telling you what the numbers are going out on Facebook about, because I've been out there. And I want to say to the school teachers, I have nothing against any of you. I think you do a great job. You earn your wage. I agree you deserve a raise, but I just cannot see funding a school meal levy at the rate that is being proposed out there. I just, if you'd have come at me with a lower amount, you might have got it. But right now, I'm voting against it. And I'm protesting and hoping a lot will stand out with me over it. And I did pull your report card. And the report card that you tried to tell me that I'm stupid, or that the governor is telling us we're done to take it at face value.
Excuse me, no one on this board, nor did our superintendent, say anything about any individual in this building or yourself being stupid.
You're right, that's my bad, my poor choice of language there. But I get emotional. but it says that you tried to imply that what the governor has put out on this report, and maybe I don't know how to read it.
It's not the government's Ohio Department of Education.
Okay, but it says .gov, so I'm, and it says government, and it's the Ohio, it's, matter of fact, where is the website that I went to? It is the report card .education.ohio.gov is exactly where it went. And I have to commend the sixth grade a math teacher, because whoever that is Purdue, is doing a wonderful job. I mean, they're straight A's, 100%. I couldn't ask for anything better. But when I'm looking at the scores that I look at, it says the progress, we're failing. You know, and our school is failing at the rate we're at. And, you know, when I go and look at a report like this, whether I understand it 100% or not, if I see an F on there, that means it makes me think to say that you guys are bad. Our children, my grandchildren. And I can just go by what's published out there. And you're telling me that what I'm seeing is not true. But, you know, right now I'm running on emotion. A lot of people are running on emotion. You guys are running on emotion. You want a raise, and I don't blame you. You know, everybody wants a raise. But the governor told me there's no inflation, I don't get a raise. You know, that if anything, we're going into a recession because the stock market's declining. I'm losing money hand over fist, as you guys' as retirements are too, I'm sure. So I just can't see doling out more money when all I see is losses on my checkbook left and right. And when I'm dealing with losses, that means I have to cut my spending. I mean, when I see, okay, this check went up this much, I got to cut something to pay that bill. You know, because nobody brings me any more money.
It's not about the raises, it's about the students. But that's what we're here for.
All I have been hearing is, we haven't had a raise. We haven't had a raise.
That's hearsay.
No, this is what I am hearing.
Let's keep it simple.
Yeah, on the internet.
I'm just telling you what I've been hearing. It's all about
raise. Yeah.
And it's my concern is you guys are getting staff raises for years of service. However, the quality of education, it says, is not improving. And I'm going based on the Ohio report. I pulled it up. Everybody that doesn't believe what I'm talking about will pull it up. I have the website here for you. So I think we should really be concerned. Yes, K through three, third grade, they've got excellent grades. You know, they are wonderful. Great job. Y'all have an excellent education. It's fourth through 12th grade, that's a problem. Other than sixth grade math teacher, great go, sixth grade math teacher. You know, hey, I'm glad you're back, or whoever they are. You know, and I was reading on this report that the gifted students, their meds are needs aren't even being met. You know, their needs aren't even being met. Our disabled students, their needs aren't even being met. You know, the kids going into college have to take an additional reading class just to pass or be able to go into college level English classes. They have to have a supplemental English class and pay for it out of their pocket to meet the standards of the colleges. I'm looking at the report.
Is this, ma'am?
Yeah.
What you're stating about these children, do you have facts that we have multiple students, or are you saying,
because
I don't have.
I'm basing it off of the report that I found on site.
Okay, you're
good. We will, for everyone's information, we will link that, 5 minutes, but we'll still let you finish up. We will link that to the website so that you can see and you can compare. Keep in mind, I stated earlier, we were just as surprised to get an F in one category. That category was called value added. But we also had, in fifth grade language arts, the highest in a six-county region with an 87.1 in the previous report. And if you look, it will also show you there's a big article in the Cleveland Plain Dealer how 400 and some odd schools across the state are questioning the test results. That same document, same thing, just came out. And if you pull it up on every Brown County school and other surrounding schools, you'll see that each one has an F somewhere.
I know Indian Hill's really upset.
Indian Hill had a D, yes. We looked everywhere. Now, if you pull up Mason's, they were very, 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 very good. So there are a few out there, but if you just do your research, and it's a great point.
Well, it was shocking for me when I got...
I think it was just as shocking for us. Thank you for sharing. We're at the beyond the 5 minute mark. We're going to try to stay. But we'll also put your link on the website.
Very good.
We want to be as open as we possibly can be. Next person. Let's see here.
The clipboard.
Somebody else wants to sign it. Oh, Joanna has it.
I left the full one here.
Here it is. Ellen Molitor.
Said at the beginning we were streaming.
No, but personally.
We're tape recording it.
That's right.
And we're streaming it to the website.
Live. Right.
Fix the mic for Alan.
It's still not working.
Mic. Hang on.
Address.
On Lorelei Drive, McNorley. I was a farm wife since 1953. I know what it is to farm. I run combines, I've done tractors, I've done it all. And I think many of you who knew me know that. I know that the land, at one time we owned 600 acres. Didn't have over $200 an acre in it. Would you take that for your farm today? Stop and think. I was down at the auditor's office and just last week, and they told me that one piece of property between Knobhorn and Fayetteville had just sold for $6,000 an acre. I want to tell you, farmers, stick with it. In the long run, it will pay. I hope you did not have to go through. Do not have to go through what I've been through, trying to make a living with 10 children, but we made it. And they've all graduated from Fayetteville. They are all taxpaying citizens today. I have from teachers to office managers in the hospitals in Cincinnati. I have a daughter, Angela, which I'm very proud of. She's come to the meetings. I've came to several meetings and I don't know where you were. I think that this is something to think about. Farmers are investors. One of the young men who came to live at my farm, and I had down to 300 acres, that he wanted to know if he could bid on the last bidder. When I got my price, I left. My buildings were needing repair. I had no help. My children were coming back into farming. It's a tough world out there. My children never had a car at 16 years of age. They shared the car that we had and a pickup truck. And we many times walked to school. I myself, I can tell you, worked in the school system of Fayetteville High School. On my lunch, I was in seventh to the 12th grade. My kids had peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. What do you want to give up for yours? I can remember the board members, I had a couple. The Holdens, Blanches, the Metzgers, the Houts, the Burrs, the Kylies, the Rats, all share in being board members of Fayetteville-Perry Schools. They all have led what we have. I think there was a one time when we had an opportunity to build the new schools here, if I'm not mistaken, the state paid us 82 cents on the dollar to build this.
84
cents on the dollar to build, I'm sorry. Correct. We have not, we now have the obligation of this generation and our future, our children's future, to at least educate them. And do it in this. The other one is taking computer science. Farming is not an easy occupation, but we are the investors in our community. If we can't pay our taxes, then I say sell out and go. My mother was a teacher who graduated from Fayetteville High School with 3 years of high school and she couldn't make it into Wilmington College because they couldn't take a senior coming out of a three-year high school. My father was a bus driver. He owned his own two buses at one time. He died of a heart attack when I was 16 and the oldest of four. My mother went back to teaching, no clothes to any of her teachers, for $3,500 a year with four children to raise. I know what it is to be without. I am enjoying my retirement, but it is a long-term investment. Make a place for your children to say, I want to come back and live in the Fayetteville community because of their excellence in our schools.
A senior coffee a day to support my community is embarrassing. Yes, I will pay that because this community deserves it. This is one of the best school districts that I have had the opportunity to observe. I've worked in some. I don't have a dog in this fight. My children went to school in Maryland. My grandchildren go to school all over the country. This is a primo school. I would have my grandkids here in a heartbeat if they would come home. But I think we all, I cannot understand the economics of what farmers are going through today. I know it's a challenge. I know that I also am on a welfare budget. I'm retired too. But I will tell you that it's worth my senior coffee a day to know that this school will continue to be a bright spot and the center of this community. And I'm going to ask everyone to please join me in supporting this community. Before I leave, I want to congratulate John Doshi. I understand that he was nominated as the state's best, which only goes to show that this place is special. Nowadays, bullies.
Yeah.
And we vote them. culture of public employees in this nation. I'm not saying all public employees fall into this pattern, but it's a very acceptable mindset. I deserve it. You don't know what I go through. I deserve your money. You make too much anyway. What's wrong with people being successful in this nation? We got to take away what they got and give it to other people. That is a wrong mindset. We're talking about our kids going to school in the future. What, do we want them to succeed in the future? Or are we going to take everything they got? I mean, that lady said up there earlier, she said, what, are you going to cut my veins and pull it out of me if I don't have it? I mean, where do we think we're going to keep on getting money from? I guess since so many businesses and corporations have gone overseas, that we're going to get it wherever we can. I mean, it's just not the right mindset. It's not the right mindset. I want to see schools succeed. Right now, my oldest is in Williamsburg High School. They are doing an awesome job. The Boosters spent years working to raise money to get the track and football field where they need to be. Lynchburg's done a great job too. I think there's solutions to problems without unfairly taxing people and then telling them they got too much already. Is this a country where we want people to succeed? I think we're just headed toward a future where everybody's going to be a public employee. That's sad. We need private industry. But we punish people when they have their own business. And we take away from them. It's just not the right mindset. That's not the way things should be. I think we need a history lesson to help us succeed again. And teachers, I have heard what an awesome job you do here. And I'm so glad. But being to yell at people, bully, and get kids to go home and tell their parents they got to vote for the levy? I've heard some of the yelling tonight. I've heard the yelling going on.
Students, your family members, and most importantly, our kids. I've been a teacher in Claremont County for the past 7 years, and I've been privileged to coach here at Fayetteville-Perry High School, a place that I call home. I get to interact every day with our young students, the kids that roam the community, and kids that look up and need guidance from educators. While all of you take a second and think about the place that you call home, it's like a bad vacation. You always want to go home. Where is that home? It's right here. Imagine the memories that you've made here within the community, and even some of you in which are alumni here. There are familiar faces within the crowd tonight that I see that are very supportive at basketball games, different events. As you look around at one another, you should ask yourself, also, Speaker, I believe not one person in this room wants to pay any more money in taxes. No one wants to. It's like there's many roadblocks, there's many detours. We've got to find a way to make it happen. As I see this levy begin to divide our community and kill many friendships among one another, I would ask you to look at the person beside you again and say, if I vote yes or I vote no, will it affect the future? As I see the negativity floating around, I see a lot of misinterpreted information that you need to first understand and come to the facts and be willing to understand the government funding, the state of Ohio funding for public education. No matter how many flyers we circulate about teachers' pay, you cannot put a price on students' education. In today's world, knowledge is power, and power is money. I currently make $6,000 more per year than any teacher within this district that has 7 years' experience. I work 13 minutes from here. I personally owe many credits to the students, to the faculty members that sat in here tonight, because they are who I am today. I would never step in a college classroom without their guidance, without them being a role model. Once again, I look at myself and I say, where do I come from? I've seen other school districts and how they operate as a community. I will tell you that Fayetteville-Perry Local Schools, in my eyes, is the hidden gem in Brown County. The test scores prove this. The athletic programs prove this. The graduation rates prove this. These amazing facilities prove this. And most importantly, our students' education prove this. I, like many of you, know exactly where I came from and exactly what home looks like. I know that no matter how much we argue about this issue, not everyone's going to agree, and I understand that. I ask that you please listen to the facts and believe in our students' education and what these teachers are doing with these kids and the education they provide them. We as adults are responsible for always making and finding a way for our students and our families. Thank you.
Graduated from X. You probably see him wearing his patch jacket every place he goes around. evening, everyone. Randy Carson, 542 North Main Street, Fayetteville. I come to you as the village mayor. When I ran for mayor, I ran on the fact that we have good schools, we have a good fire department, and we need police protection. Those are the three things that you must have. And I have family in the farming business. And we need that. We need that balance to make everything work. When I was asked, along with Carol, to chair the levy committee. And it was very easy for me to do it because it's something that I believe in. It's been mentioned, we don't like taxes. I guarantee you there's not a person in here. And I believe it was Mrs. Johnson that stated it quite well. But the fact that the one thing that we can't do is we can't divide as a community. I mean, the things that are being said about teacher salaries, every teacher that's in here right now, if you would please stand up. I don't care if you're not in the district or not. Now, here's what I'd like for you to do. Every teacher in here that all their student loans are paid off, have a seat. Congratulations to you guys. You must have been doing it for 20 years or 15. The fact of the matter is, I have a daughter that's going to college right now, and she wants to follow in her mother's footsteps and do math. And I appreciate Stacy that does that for a living. If I need something to grow, I'm going to the farmers. If I need someone to be taught, I'm going to the teachers. We all have to work together in this community. Now, whether you vote yes or whether you vote no, that is entirely up to you when you go to the polls. I am a supporter of the levy, and I, too, have CAUV land. I paid, it's cost me, and I don't have kids in the system, but I have, hopefully, grandkids that will be in the system. I have nieces and nephews that have kids. And one of the best movies I ever seen was Paying It Forward. And that's what I'm doing. I'm going to pay it forward. Is it going to hurt? Absolutely. I'm not going to like it, but I feel that it's my duty to do so. It costs $120,000 for my child's education. Now, the people that you've seen standing up, they may have went on and got a master's degree or something of that nature. They have too. The fact of the matter is, it then went from $120,000 to probably $160,000 or higher. So don't look at these figures and say the teachers are overpaid, because I would almost guarantee you there's no one else in here that has paid that amount of money for a job. And the they do for a living. That's all I have. Do you have a question?
Yes, you can talk about the teachers, you know, and all the school things, but it's, you know, that's a personal choice. And the same with the job that I had, if I don't tell you, that's a personal choice. I pay for that, and I'm responsible for paying that, not anybody else. And furthermore, if I come up, you know, paying tax, I've moved down here for about 18 years, lived out on 2141 Woodville Road, taxes $640, now they're at $3,000, now they're above $4,000. I'm the big thing, but I'm retired. And how many people out here mail me out, let them say, hey, we're going to foreclose on you, so you can't pay your tax, move out of your house for pennies on the dollar tomorrow? How many few people are willing to come out and say, hey, I'll help you out, keep your little town? I agree, we need to look at that, but we're not just going on the city, we're going to go on 83 months, dollars a day, and where are we headed?
Hey, sir, now, I'm happy to have you speak.
Yeah.
You want to sign a sheet, you can have 5 full minutes.
I don't want 5 minutes.
I thought I was getting a question. Well, I can answer that the best I can. And I'm sorry if I run over 5 minutes, but you're right, it is their choice. And I applaud them for it, because this school deserves it, and this community deserves it. I'm not trying to make anybody feel bad or... By no means. All I'm trying to do is, that is a fact.
Not that we can't afford it. I'm sure everybody can afford taxes. But when you're retired, you can afford. You maybe afford it until they foreclose on your house,
right,
and someone pays it. So right now, I'm sure I can afford as much as what.